Let's turn our Bibles to Book of Jeremiah, Jeremiah chapter 33. Jeremiah chapter 33. We're going to look at one verse. Jeremiah chapter 33, verse 3. Jeremiah chapter 33, verse 3. The title of the message is, You Have a Lifeline. You have a lifeline. Jeremiah chapter 33, verse 3. Call unto me, and I will answer thee, and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. Brother Kevin, can you please pray for the message?
Dear Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you again that we get to gather, praise you, worship you, and study your word, Lord. Lord, just wanted to pray for those people that have been the victim of the recent tornadoes out there, Lord, that swept across six states from Arkansas all the way to Kentucky. And Kentucky is especially hard struck, Lord. We just pray for Brother David and mm-hmm. Sister Bonnie that they're safe out there. Yes. And Lord, just have mercy on these souls, Lord. Lord, a lot of people will say that this is because of global warming, but Lord, it's you telling us that the end is near, Lord. And I just pray that people will open their eyes and see that things are happening really fast, Lord. And you know, we just thank you once again for our salvation, Lord. So, you know, we just, you know, can appreciate enough every day that we wake up knowing that we're going to heaven once you come for us or we leave this world. Lord, it's just, it's a peace that is truly beyond understanding, Lord. And we pray that those who are missing out on this peace may receive you as their Lord and Savior as well. Amen. Please fill Pastor Jae with your Holy Spirit. Yes. Feed us your word through him, Lord. Help us, convict us, teach us the lesson you want us to learn. Yes. Help us to walk in the Spirit. Thank you so much for everything you bless us with. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen.
You have a lifeline, as Brother Calvin prayed. And a lot of unfortunate things are happening in the world. We have a pandemic going on, like he mentioned. We had a tornado, you know, many people died because of that. We have earthquakes everywhere. You know, we have unrest everywhere. You know, people are dying left and right. You know, law's not even law anymore. Especially, you know, we know even in this state, California, you have a lot of robberies, everything going on. But you know, law isn't doing much. You know, I'm sure you've seen the videos, what happened in San Francisco. You know, businesses can't even operate properly nowadays. They're just afraid that, you know, a group of thugs will come and steal things. A lot of department stores are closing at 6 or before, you know, sun goes down. Why? Because, you know, they know they will come and steal, burglarize their property, but law doesn't do anything about it. They pass some prop, you know, up to $950 is like a misdemeanor. It's like a slap in the wrist, right? So they know the law. I mean, sometimes those thieves, you know, criminals, they know the law a lot better than you and I. Say they know the limit. Okay, that bag is about, you know, $900. But guess what? It's not just, it's not cumulative. I was shocked. It goes by each store. So I get 950, 949 here, 949 there, 949 there. It's still a misdemeanor. And then people say, what's wrong with this state? What's wrong with this country? What's wrong with this world? Because all these things are leading to one thing, right? Yes. You know, it's all leading to, you know, all this one world globalist coming together. But during these days, as Christians, you shouldn't be dejected. You shouldn't be discouraged. You shouldn't be thinking about suicide. You have a lifeline. We saw it in our verse today. Bible says, call unto me, and I will answer thee and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. You and I have an incredible privilege and opportunity and responsibility to use this lifeline. You know, there's some game shows out there, right? They say, use that lifeline. However, if lifeline doesn't work, what happens? they lose, right? But we have a lifeline that we'll never lose.
Amen.
Think about it. Who's on that lifeline? You know, our God Almighty, yes. Lord Jesus Christ. It's just that Christians do not use that lifeline often enough. It's a rare lifeline. It's like you don't go there too often. It's like, it's almost like that game show. You only go when you're super desperate. You only go when you're hurting, when you're at the bottom, when you can't breathe anymore, almost at that moment.
True.
When you should go to that lifeline on a daily basis, on a very, very, almost like a conversational places. People in the world are sick of it. Unsaved or saved, they're sick of this world. They see what's going on everywhere. And as you know, people who can't handle it, they want to die. And it's not just you. It's not just you listening. There are many people out there, saved, unsaved. So mental health, you know, it's not strong enough because they're not going to that lifeline. So what happens is that they think about other options, the other options that devil is giving you. Think about it, even to Christian. You know, I want to end my life. You know, now I want to do something for God, but things are not working out. In my point of view, it's not God's point of view. You always look at your point of view instead of looking at God's point of view. It's not happening, right? You know, my relationship is not happening. You know, my work is not going well. You know, family issues and everything. And Christians, I mind you, and these are not, you know, young Christians. These are Christians who's been saved for many, many years. They're thinking, you know what? You know, I might have to just end my life. You know, they say, I want to go to heaven early. If Christians feel like that, how much do you think unsaved people feel like? You know, there is actually a machine that's made in Switzerland. And Switzerland, they have assisted suicide. So many people fly out to Switzerland to die. Think about that, right? Because their life is so bad, horrible, that, you know what? I'm just going to go somewhere where I could die legally, right? I mean, you can't just go to some doctor here and say, oh, you know what? Doctor, kill me. No, you know, laws are in place in U.S. But in Switzerland, you could actually get assisted, you know, suicide. So this guy actually made a coffin-like capsule pod. So it's like, you know, it looked kind of cool. It's like, you know, from like the future. You know, you press a button, like thing opens up, you go in there, you press the button, thing closes, and you press another button and you die. Think about that. So after the push of the button, the pod becomes filled with nitrogen gas. It gets filled with nitrogen gas and oxygen levels go down, and then causing the user to faint within a minute or two. And the person dies of, you know, oxygen deprivation, just like that. But they say they don't suffocate. They say they don't suffer. And these are in place. How many people do you think will start flying out to Switzerland? You know, a lot of people will go. Once this gets, you know, approved, everything, you know. Why? Because they look for a lifeline, but they can't find it. They seek lifeline through people, through world, through pleasure, through money, everything. But it doesn't work. They just don't have peace. They don't have anything. So what do? You know what? I have nothing to live for in this world. I try to use all my lifeline. It did not work at all. So what's going to happen? I'm going to give up my life. And that's why you see many, many people, young and old, just dropping dead. Because they have no will to live anymore. But as Christians, I mean, have you been at that place where, you know what, you know, I don't want to go on anymore. You know, this is not worth the living. I mean, we have hymns, right? You know, this life is worth the living.
Amen.
However, many people one day, for whatever reason, because of their circumstances, because of their relationship, you will feel it. It's not something that you'll never feel because you are a human being and you're weak. So when things don't go well, you're going to feel like, you know what? If I die, I'm going to go to heaven, which is the best thing. But is that God's will for you right now, that you go to heaven right now? I mean, you're here, you're alive, so probably not, right? Then you're going against the will of God, but because of your own sorry state, you're like, you know what? I got to let it go. I want to just, hey, Lord, just take me home. I mean, how many of you ever pray like that, right? You know, don't raise your hand here, you know. I mean, just raise your hand in your heart. Like, how many times where you felt like, you know what? My life needs to stop right now. But without thinking about the big picture, you're just looking at your own way and selfish ways, and you're like, you know what? I just want to give up, and I just want to stop. I'm sure some people have gone through that mental state. You have to understand those things come about because you're lacking something. What is that you're lacking? You're lacking that prayer. You're lacking that, you know, lifeline usage. You don't talk to the Lord enough. It hasn't become part of your life. That's why you forget that you have a lifeline. And this lifeline needs to be used every single day. Again, I mentioned from the beginning, it shouldn't be happening when you have cancer. It shouldn't be happening when you have $0 in your bank account. It shouldn't be happening when you and your spouse are fighting every single day. It shouldn't be happening when your children are going to jail. No, it should be happening every single day. You need to be using this lifeline. And what does that mean? It means that you continuously have conversation with the Lord Jesus Christ. You have a fellowship with Lord Jesus Christ all the time. When you fall in love, you know, we have brother and sister who's going to get married soon. How often do you think they converse? How often do you think they talk? They probably talk very often, right? Because they love each other. And a lot of times when days go by without talking to each other, probably they feel like, oh, man, it doesn't feel like I'm living, right? Because that's how much love each person has. When was the last time you felt like that, right? You felt like with the Lord Jesus Christ, where you love him so much that you have to talk to him, and then when you don't talk to him, you feel like something's missing. It feels like, man, this day was not worth the living. Think about it. If two people who love each other don't talk to each other even for a single day, even 2 days or 3 days, you know, they're going to feel like something's very missing in their heart. I mean, married people, you know for sure. I mean, if you don't feel it right now, but you felt it days before when you guys really loved each other, right? Which you should be feeling right now, right? As time passes by, your love should grow instead of dwindle, right? Amen. It should become bigger instead of becoming smaller. Yeah. And it should become brighter instead of becoming darker. Then, as you know, and you know that feeling for many of you, then when was last time, or if ever, you felt like, you know what? My fellowship time with the Lord Jesus Christ, the conversations that I have with the Lord, is the most important thing in my life. Mind you, it's not about you and your spouse right now, your girlfriend and boyfriend. It's your children, your grandpa, grandma, people around you. The most important thing should be in your life is your fellowship with Lord Jesus Christ. And it comes down to the conversations that you have with the Lord every single day. How much did you talk to him yesterday? How much did you talk to him day before? How much did you talk to him last week? How much did you talk to him this year? Right? I know for sure for some of you, next 3 weeks before the year ends, if you spend maybe at least 30 minutes to an hour talking to the Lord, that will be more than the first 12 months, 11 months. Why? Because you don't think it's important. Again, when I talked about that suicide pod, you know, what kills the person? Lack of oxygen. You should think of having conversation and fellowship with the Lord like your oxygen tank, your oxygen level in your life. For many listening, for many here, I know that your oxygen level is at bare bottom. You know, if you were to compare your fellowship with the Lord and your oxygen level, it's probably at the really, really near bottom. You know, Like, only by grace of God and mercy of God, you're still breathing, right? And your oxygen level is super low. Then you have to recognize that, man, I need to have increased my oxygen level. You know, how do you do that? Some people do it with the machine, right?
Yes.
And they have help. However, spiritually speaking, in order for you to do that, you got to start talking to the Lord more. You got to spend more time with Him. You have to think about, okay, first priority in my life, first thing that I need to do before I ask somebody, before I fellowship, do anything, I need to start talking to the Lord. It's not only about the big things that you speak to the Lord about. It includes smaller things, right? You know, what am I going to do today? You know, when it comes to driving, when it comes to eating, when it comes to every little detail, do you go to the Lord first? If you don't go to the Lord first, you can't guarantee that Lord's going to bless it, right? You don't even talk to Him. I mean, there are conditions out there. Let's turn our Bibles to the book of James. James chapter 4. James chapter 4. So think about your prayer life. Think about how much you use your lifeline. A lot of times, you are where you are in a dejected state or discouraged state because you don't use it. You don't go to the Lord. James chapter 4. Let's look at verse 1. James chapter 4, verse 1. Bible says, "From whence come wars and fightings among you? Come they not hence, even your lusts that war in your members? Eat lust and have not, eat kill and desire to have and cannot obtain. Ye fight and war, yet ye have not, because ye ask not. Ye ask and receive not, because ye ask amiss, that ye may consume it upon your lust." A lot of times your lust of the flesh will get in the way. But even before that, you don't even ask, right? You don't ask the Lord. You think that you're self-sufficient. You think that you're self-reliable. You think that you can do everything on your own. That's where you got into devil's trap, and that's where you're stuck. You think, I could do it. I can do this. You know, even driving per se, right? If Lord doesn't protect you, what do you think is going to happen to you? But a lot of times you think that I am a good driver or I'm a great driver. That's why I don't get into accident. That's why I don't get tickets. Wrong. It's because the Lord's protecting you and because of the Lord's grace. You know, you're still here. But even those little things, do you go to the Lord in prayer, right? Do you talk to Him? Lord, I'm going to drive to church today. Lord, please protect me every step of the way. You know, without your protection, you know, I don't know what's going to happen. I mean, do you even talk to Him for every little thing? Or many of you just came to church just expecting and just come. And sometimes Lord have to wake you up. Sometimes you see those two lights behind you, right? And you go, oh, did I pray today? Probably not. You know, sometimes, you know, someone hits you from the rear. Like, oh, did I pray? I did not pray, right? And sometimes, you know, you get into a bigger accident. Oh, man, I've been warned in the past, you know. But I still haven't really talked with the Lord. It just shows that you don't really ask the Lord. You know, in order to survive in this wicked world controlled by the devil, you need wisdom from God. You definitely do. Yes. Now, how are you going to get wisdom from God without talking to Him, without asking for it on a daily basis? You know, we say, you know, when we wake up, Lord, please fill with the Holy Ghost, right? We want to live a, you know, spirit-filled life. But in order for you to do that, you need wisdom from the Lord. There are certain decisions that you make. You know, you're going to make the wrong decisions without the wisdom of God. In order for you to get that wisdom, you have to pray. You have to have conversation. You know, people say, what is an effectual prayer life? Your effectual prayer life is having conversation with the Lord about anything and about everything, every single day. It's not about only the, you know, things that you feel important you pray to the Lord about. Every little thing that seems like, you know, minute, doesn't seem that important, you talk to the Lord about it. That's when people spend hours actually on their knees, standing up, sitting down, just praying and talking to the Lord. You have to check yourself. I mean, Do you think you spend enough time with the Lord in fellowship on a daily basis? I mean, no one, I don't think, could say yes, unless you dedicate 24/7 like that with all of your heart in it. That's why you and I recognize that we're not perfect, and we still strive to get better and better, not on our own, but with the wisdom of God. If there's a job that you need to get, that job that you want, do you go to the Lord in prayer first? Or do you try to, you know, check your resume, check your qualification first? Because a lot of people will do that. You know, they're like, you know what? Lord, I need a new job, okay? Even before that, you're like, okay, let's see what jobs are available out there. You know, it's time for my career change, you know, I need a better job, better work, you know. You're like looking at it and like, okay, you know, I have this degree, I have this certification, I have this experience, bunch of stuff, you know. You're like, you make your own check marks, right? Instead of going to the Lord first. You know, after you think you do all of your thing and you go to the Lord, you know, I think I'm okay, so help me, Lord. When did you go to the Lord? At the beginning of the process? Or at the end of the process? A lot of times you go to the Lord at the end of the process. Then what happens? What's going to happen? When something goes bad, you start blaming the Lord. But in the first place, you didn't go to the Lord. It's like you're raising your kid. You're like, okay, son, just ask me. And I'll show you how to make this or build this thing right. So the kid's like, you know what? I'm good. I'm well-versed. I'm talented. So he builds this machine. But he did it wrong. Goes to the father. Father goes, hey, you know, let me show you the right way. But in order for him to show the right way, what's got to happen? He has to break everything down. Waste time, right? It shows that you weren't that, you know, smart. You had no wisdom. Wisdom comes from God. You know, wisdom comes from God. That's how you seek wisdom. And you're like, okay, I've done wrong. How could that have been prevented? If you went to the Lord from the beginning. If that son went to the father, you know, father, I'm trying to build this thing. You know, how should I do it? I think I have my own idea, but, you know, I'm going to go with you because, you know, you're always wiser than me. Can any of you say that you're more wiser than God? No. All of you know that God is wiser than you, right?
Yes.
Unless you're the devil. I mean, unless any of you guys are devil in this room. Then if you know that God is wiser, and if you know that he gives you wisdom, then why don't you go to him? I mean, it's like a rhetoric question, cliche question, but it must be asked because you and I don't do it on a daily basis. Why don't you go to the Lord for everything from the beginning instead of at the end? So what happens at the end is that you've already did your own way. Then what happens? A lot of times you committed those sins already.
Yes.
And a lot of times you have sown bad things on the ground already. And you have to wait until, you know, it grows out, has the fruit, bears the fruit,
yes.
And then you have to reap what you sow. Then you become what? You wasted many time, Lord's time, and you're down in the gutter. And at that time, many people can't get up either. That's why many people are too discouraged, too bitter, and they just quit. Well, even though there's a lifeline out there, we just saw it. However bad your situation is, you can go to the Lord. However, you know, hard you think your situation is, you can't go to the Lord. You know, Lord could always resolve things. You know, Lord will have answers for you, especially if you trusted him, and especially if, you know, he's your Lord and Savior. Lord will take care of you. It's just that you just don't go to him. You have to reiterate, and it has to be reiterated in your heart and in your life that you do not go to the Lord enough. Think about it. When I want to achieve a goal, in order for me to do that, I have to take this step, that step, another step to get up, to reach that goal. Then you got to do it continuously. In order for you to really know that you have that lifeline, what do you have to do? You have to continuously go to the Lord. And you have your relationship with the Lord has to grow. I mean, the most important thing in your life as a Christian is your relationship with Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. You talk to any single preacher, brother, sister, you know that most important thing in your life is your relationship with Lord Jesus Christ. You say it, you profess it, you confess it, but do you live it, right? We always talk the talk, but how many of us really walk the walk? I mean, how many of you really, really put relationship with Lord Jesus Christ as your number one thing, number one priority in your life? I should talk to the Lord first before I talk to my wife. I should talk to the Lord first before I talk to my boss, co-workers, my children, my grandchildren, or anybody.
Yes.
You should be talking to the Lord first before anything else that you talk to anybody. It should become your priority. It's like, it's simple things too, right? You have your little kid and you want to talk to the kid, but you know, you need some wisdom to talk to the kid. Raising kids is not easy. Ask any parent out there. If they say raising kid is easy, they're lying. They haven't seen what's going to happen, you know, 2 years from now, 3 years from now, even a month from now, what's going to happen. Then it's not an easy thing. Then how are you going to make it as best as possible? By talking to the Lord. Lord, please help me. You know, I'm raising my kid, you know, he or she, right, or they. I think I know what I'm doing, but you know what? I'm nothing. I need you to help me, Lord. You know, give me wisdom to raise my children right, right? Then you won't have any regrets when things go haywire because you know that you've done your best and you know Lord's in complete control.
Amen.
But when you start not seeking the Lord, when you don't go to that lifeline, and then when you think that you could solve everything on your own, what's going to happen? Man, suddenly your kid is in trouble. Your kid is acting up. Your kid is actually so-called Christian, but doing all the wicked things that world people are doing, getting into trouble, called by the principal's office, right? Even police station. What has gone wrong? It starts with you, mother and father, because you did not go to the Lord. When you realize that fellowship with the Lord is the most important thing, what's going to happen? You start realizing that Lord has to bless it in order for it to succeed. You really start realizing it. Okay. And then you know Lord's going to bless it by having more conversation with him. If two people are in love and they have a conversation on a regular basis and they're going to start understanding and they're going to know what he likes, what she likes, what he doesn't like, and what she doesn't like, right? If she doesn't like, say, you know, certain type of food, you're not going to say, you know what, honey, let's go eat this food today, right? If they don't like spicy food, you'll be like, you know what, we're not going to go eat spicy food because I learned that from our conversation. Yeah. But if you don't know each other, what's going to happen? You love spicy food. You know a great place where they serve spicy food, and no one ever said bad things about that spicy food because whoever goes there loves spicy food in the first place. Non-spicy food eaters don't go there. You take that loved one, go to that restaurant, the person takes a first bite, and then they go to the bathroom and don't come out for 30 minutes, and then they say, you know what, it's over. You know, they're like, what's over? You know, we're getting out of here. Why does that happen? You look embarrassed, right? The person's feeling bad, and the diet has gone wrong horribly. Why? Because you did not understand that other person, it's not a blessing for them to be in that restaurant. But you would have known if you had more conversation with that person. You would have known if you asked, right? What do you like? What do you not like? Obviously, you do that on a personal basis in the first place. But when it comes to your spiritual life, why don't you go talk to the Lord like that? Lord, you know, it's kind of like a gray area in the Bible. It's not yes or no. I don't know what to do. Is this the right thing to do? Man, then Lord's going to give you wisdom. Lord will answer you. Lord will answer your prayer. But you think you know it, you go on with it, and things fail, and you start blaming God. God, you don't love me. You don't love me like that, brother. You don't love me like that, sister. You know, when it all comes back to whose fault was it? It was your fault. It's my fault. It's your fault. It's each person's fault. Yeah. It's not time for you to start putting blame on anybody else. When it comes to prayer life, especially prayer life, you're your own responsibility. It's you who make it, you know, succeed. It's you who will make it fail. It's not your mom, it's not your dad, it's not your wife or husband, it's not your children, it's not your grandpa, grandma, it's not your coworkers. It's you who will determine whether you will have a good or great relationship with Lord Jesus Christ or not. Then, if you don't get anything out of this message, you should at least understand, do I make my fellowship with Lord Jesus Christ as my top priority? Do I have conversation with my Lord Jesus Christ more often than anybody else? Think about that. When you look at George Mueller, you know, when you look at, you know, Dr. Ruckman, when you look at all the forefathers of faith, who do you think they talk to the most on a daily basis? They talk to Lord Jesus Christ the most. Not only on their knees for hours and stuff, just regular. While they're driving, while they're walking, you know, while they're thinking, before they speak to anybody, right? Don't you think we have, I mean, isn't it a great, 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 you know, privilege that we could actually talk to the Lord without even saying it, right? Even in my heart, I could talk to the Lord right now, right? That's what the Nehemiah prayer is, right? In Nehemiah chapter 2. He prayed right before he talked. You and I should be doing that all the time. Before our next words come out, right? We should be talking to the Lord. Lord, please give me wisdom. Lord, lead me in the right direction. Lord, I trust in you, Lord. Help me, Lord. I mean, it's just a short verses, short phrases, but it goes a long way. It just builds up. You know, what do your husband and wife and your children, your family appreciate the most? When you ask them for their opinion, right? When you truly want to understand how they feel, what they want, right? Like, honey, before I make a decision, I do want to know how you feel about it. Because a lot of times fights happen. Why? Because you think or you pretend or you think that you know what they're wanting. Right? You think that they want this cream pie when they wanted something else the whole time. Like, oh, enjoy, right? And then they grudgingly eat it and stuff, right? And then days or two or some later, oh, you know, I really didn't like it, but I just didn't want you to feel bad about it, right? All those things could have been avoided, what? When you would have talked to them in the first place. And some people do that well. Like they make decisions together as husband and wife, you know, children as well. They help them understand, right? You never want to tell someone to do it without helping them understand, unless they don't have capacity to understand. Then they'll just follow, right? But with your husband and wife, you guys have capacity to understand each other. That's why you sit till death do us part. That's why you guys are together. Then you get a lot better relationship when you guys talk to each other, communicate with each other constantly. And you know what each person would like to be done. Then when it comes to Lord Jesus Christ, just think about it. You know what? Anything that I do, anything, from the most minute things to the biggest thing, I need Lord's blessing for it to succeed, right? It doesn't matter. I could have the greatest plan. I planned out to A to Z, every step of the way. And you have 100% confidence that, you know what, this is going to work. He worked for so-and-so and so-and-so, and he's going to work for me. However, if Lord doesn't bless it, it's not going to work. Simple as that. Even if you think you're 1,000% sure that it's going to work, if Lord doesn't bless it, it's not going to work, right? You're like, this business deal I'm going to have with my client, you know what? I've done everything. But you never went to the Lord, and the Lord hasn't blessed it, then what's going to happen? And it doesn't work out? It's not going to work out. That's why your best will never be good enough unless the Lord blesses it, right? Then you have to recognize it. Is what I'm doing, Lord going to bless it? Then a lot of times you'll stop sinning. A lot of sins that you do, you'll just stop right away. You go to that lifeline, Lord, you know what? I'm going to go to that bar and win this for you. Lord gives you, he gives you wisdom. Don't do it, man. You got to abstain from all appearance evil. Like that Bible verse just comes to you. Okay. Thank you. I realize that you're not going to bless it, right? I'm not going to do it. Right? You're somewhere else. Right? Lord, you know, I do want to, you know, you guys have love for the lost souls out there. And I do want to win this. You know, I want that soul to get saved. And then before, the Lord wants everyone to get saved. But how much do you want that person to get saved, right? So you pray. And you know for sure that the Lord will bless it when you talk to that person about salvation. Then you have that conviction. And Lord's going to give you more wisdom. Like, for example, like when you're having conversation with somebody, like your family member, your cousin, you know, your family, and you're trying to witness to them, and they ask this curveball question, right? They might ask, you know, some people say earth is flat, you know? How do you think about that, right? You know, I mean, what was before Adam and Eve, you know? And then, you know, sometimes, like, you didn't even prepare for it, but Lord gives you wisdom to answer it. Steer it the right way, because Lord will bless that. Then, in conclusion, think about it. In your life, do you seek and ask the Lord all the time? I'm not saying sometimes, all the time. And do you realize that having conversation, fellowship with the Lord is the most important thing in your life? Do you realize that before you talk to your wife, your husband, or anybody for that matter, before day begins, that you should talk to the Lord first? And you should constantly talk to the Lord over and over and over. Do you realize that he should be the person that you talk to most on a daily basis? Then your oxygen level will continuously grow, and you have more life in your Christian life. You're not going to be people who's thinking about Switzerland, trying to fly out there to end their life. You're going to be that person who wants to preach the gospel, who wants to, you know, please the Lord, whose life is full of Lord. Think about it. If I'm full of Lord Jesus Christ, man, that's the best thing that could ever happen to me. Yes. I mean, is your life full of Jesus Christ? It's not going to happen unless you spend time with him. It's not going to happen when you think it's number one priority. It's not going to happen unless you speak to him more than anybody else in the world, not just single day, weeks, months, year, every time. Then you will know that, you know what? I know this thing will work out. Why? Because the Lord's blessing it. I know this thing's not going to work out because the Lord's not going to bless it. You'll live a more pure life, holy life, and you'll be that Christian, right? You know, full of joy, you know, full of happiness, full of love, full of encouragement. You know, just that person just brightening the whole room to other brethren, lost souls out there. And all this happened and all this possible, why? You seek Lord's wisdom, and fellowship with the Lord is number one in your life. Use that lifeline. Let's pray. Dear Father, too many days go by. I mean, we only have like 3 weeks left before 2020 is over. And we've gone many, many days without even talking to you. Our fellowship with you is not our priority. We seek wisdom and understanding and knowledge from every other source except you, Lord. And we go to you last many times. Help us to confess our ways, Lord. Get right with you, Lord. And realize that you know, you have given us this lifeline that we could use all the time. Help us to go to you, converse with you, talk to you. Help us speak with you more than anything else in this world. And help us to grow our oxygen tank level up and up in our spiritual life. We pray that you'll be with those who aren't able to make it for many reasons, especially health reasons, Lord. Please heal them as soon as possible so that they'll be back and be able to worship you together. And be with everyone who's here and listening, Lord, during this crazy pandemic times. Lord God, help us get closer to you, keep our testimonies, and really use this lifeline on a daily basis. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, thank you, everyone.